when I had accepted to speak to you, I had not really thought through in terms of what is it that I'm going to speak to you about. So I did what I guess every normal person does, which is to crowdsource. So this morning I went on to social media and I sent off to my various groups, what should I talk to HR people about HR, which is something that they know much more about. And I didn't get too many sort of good suggestions, so really I need to change the group that I have in social media. But having said that, let me attempt to talk a little bit about what we did and maybe speak about that for the next 15, 20 minutes and then keep about 10 to 15 minutes for questions that you may have. I most definitely sort of believe that there is a great amount of change which is happening, and I think the morning session talked a lot about it. And of course, this is a technology session, or SHRM technology, and I don't really need to tell you in terms of the changes the technology is bringing about. But let me go back in time a little bit. I joined, my working career started with Tata Steel, and I was with them for many years. And I believe that situations throw up people at different points of time who are actually needed by that organization or by that industry to actually take it forward. And this holds true even today. So when I joined Tata Steel, we used to have a guy, a very person called Rusi Modi, and Rusi Modi came from an HR, IR background. And he was really much required by Tata Steel because at that point of time, not having a strike was the most important thing that the steel industry required. And he was much needed at that point of time, and he brought to bear his tremendous experience and expertise to bear on Tata Steel, and Tata Steel did really well because of that. But then things changed in the early 90s when we had the liberalization, and what was required was modernization of the steel plants. And suddenly you needed somebody like a Dr. Irarani as the managing director to make the change happen in Tata Steel to better compete in the marketplace. Then once again it changed, and you needed somebody of a more strategic mindset, somebody more customer-centric, and that really led space for Muthu Raman to come in as the managing director. So the point that I'm making is over here is Tata Steel over the last 30 years required different people to lead it, and at different points of time needed different skill sets to lead it. And hence each one of these people who came from different backgrounds, from different functional areas, stepped forward and took it to the next level. And this is going to continue happening. So what does Tata Steel require today is obviously somebody who knows much about digital technology, one of an innovative mind, how one is able to compete with the onslaught that one sees happening in terms of not only competition from within the industry, and we see a lot of that happening, not only in India but in China, for example. And how do you compete with the Chinese steel industry, which produces in a month much more steel than India consumes in a year, which exports every year more steel than India consumes every year. So how does one compete with that? How does one compete with the fact that you will soon have driverless cars, and if you have driverless cars, the number of cars that are required will come down, and what is the impact of that on the steel industry? How do you sort of handle situations such like this? How do you sort of plan for situations like this? And I think so what Tata Steel today requires is somebody far more innovative than they've had in the past, somebody who's able to possibly see in the future and be far more adaptive to change. Which then brings me to this audience over here, and which is the role that you play and will play far more than you have been playing in the past, which is in terms of, this is all people linked, which is how do you select the right people, how do you motivate the right people, how do you nurture the right people to deliver their best, because there's a great deal of change which is happening. So really the role as far as the HR people, despite what is happening in terms of artificial intelligence, machine learning, robotics, I think the longevity of your profession is very much there. So if there is one profession which is going to continue, I believe it is the HR professional. But then, having said that, your skill sets will need to change to adapt to the new technologies which are coming in, to the new ways that technology is bringing about improvement in increasing productivity. So how do you actually sort of work with that and factor that in? In the earlier sessions, people talked about the three P's, right? People, process, or two P's, and technology. So I got a call maybe about 2 months ago from Gopi. Gopi is the CTO of the Tata Group. And he asked me, he said, what kind of company are you? So I said, we are an e-commerce company, et cetera, et cetera. So he says, what's the role of technology? I said, well, that's what we do. And what we really do is to solve problems using technology. So then he came out with this question, look, you have people, processes, technology. If you were to put certain percentages against that, as far as your company is concerned, how would you put them? And of course, the obvious thing for me to have said is, because the CTO is calling and not the CHRO, was to have said, look, 50% of what I do is because of technology. But that's not true. It is very much important to what we do, and I gave a percentage of 30% to technology and 20% to processes, and 50% to people, because it is people who are going to be looking at technology to see in terms of what can technology to help me to solve problems in a sustainable and scalable manner. And that's where we are. So mjunction was launched in the year 2000. At that point of time, it was called Mettle Junction and not mjunction. So we were supposed to be in the metal or the steel space. And very quickly after we were launched, there was a dot-com bust. So there was this massive exit of companies and people and capital from the dot-com story, who went back into traditional industry and into the traditional ways of buying and selling, and we were left alone. And it was assumed that we would also go back to the companies that we came from and give up this dream of actually building an electronic marketplace for steel. Most of us did go back. I lost 70% of my team overnight, but there's 30% who stayed back, and we sort of worked on building a solution, solving a problem which was being faced by buyers of steel and sellers of steel. But let me go back a bit. I was part of a re-engineering exercise in Tata Steel where we looked at technology in terms of re-engineering our processes. So I had some kind of a background in terms of doing this. But when we had done this in Tata Steel, we had looked at prime steel, steel which is used for automotive uses or for construction of houses. But what we did not look at was secondary steel. And that really was something which there was a horrible processes, and we said, let's tackle that. We tackled that, we were extremely successful. So Mettle Junction very quickly, in about 4 years' time, became not only profitable, but became the world's largest electronic marketplace for steel. Today, it continues to be the world's largest electronic marketplace for steel. We were encouraged by this to look at other opportunities outside steel. And the next one was coal. And today, in a methodology designed by us, over 500 million tons of coal has been sold in this country, which has given an incremental revenue of over 25,000 crores to Coal India, which is a public sector undertaking. This money, which has come to Coal India and which has really, we believe, securitized the energy requirements of our country, would otherwise have gone to the coal mafia, the middlemen. So really, this is money which has come back into Coal India for them to use in terms of improving their operations, investing in their future, mining more coal, making cleaner coal, and getting into underground mining. So that's what my company does, which is to look at issues or problems which are faced between business and another business and see how we can solve those problems in a manner which will add value to both the buyer and the seller. And if there are any value-destroying middlemen, to actually disintermediate them. So I have a team of people, today there are about 800 of us, who work on this, and of course we've launched many new junctions. So we had to change the name of the company, so Mettle Junction is now one of our business units focused on selling steel. We also have a coal junction, we also have a buy junction, and we have recently got into tea as well. So there are opportunities, tremendous opportunities in terms of what more we can do. And interestingly, I first felt that these were inefficiencies which existed within the country, and that the overseas, especially the Western world, would have better processes and systems and far more efficient. And surprise, surprise, when I found that today, the way that we sell steel, the way that we sell coal, the way that we brought about in efficiency and effectiveness to what we do is not something which has been done overseas as well. So we are really leaders as far as using the electronics marketplace is concerned, really going much beyond what they have been able to do. So there is most definitely an opportunity for us to grow overseas, which is something that we've started in the last couple of years. But we continue to have a problem, and this is in my discussion with some of you this morning as I walked around to find out how many of you had heard of mjunction, and to find out how many of you have clients or customers in the eastern region. And I found that to my dismay, there were none who had customers or any sort of linkage with the eastern region. And for that reason, we are now moving out, and we have opened up regional offices in north, south, and west. But I would urge some of you to look at the potential as far as the eastern region is concerned and see what that you can do in offering us, because I learned a great deal this morning, something extremely revolutionary in terms of what is happening as far as HR is concerned, and which would benefit companies such like mine who are largely centered out of Kolkata or out of the eastern region. I think there's a great potential which is there for you to tap into. I will really now like to end here and start getting some questions if there are from your side, and then sort of build upon those questions and give some more answers. So are there any questions that you have? Okay, so I've got one question here. Can we get to know which HCM technology, some leading companies you know? Would somebody explain to me what is HCM? Sorry? Human capital management. Technology, some leading company. I really have no idea. You tell me. I am not an HR specialist. My background is not even steel manufacturing, but in terms of selling and marketing of steel, and which went into a re-engineering, and which went into implementation of ERP and SAP, for which I was a project manager, which went into e-commerce, which went into solving problems online. So as I explained, as I mentioned earlier, the people that we have, if at all there is anything which is impeding or constraining our growth, it is not in terms of opportunities, it is having the right people with us who can think of ideas to solve problems and then actually implement those solutions. And I don't have enough of these people. So I'm looking forward to getting more such people, because the opportunities are humongous. And the opportunities of improvement are humongous in terms of business models. So we've launched 8 different verticals. We put them into 3 horizons. And each one of these is a business opportunity which can be as large as a company. So really, as far as HCM is concerned, I'm not an expert on that. Any other question that you would have? Let me also share with you, and as you know, somebody mentioned in terms of employee experience and, you know, focused in terms of what do you need to do to get people to come in on a Monday morning after a Sunday evening. And of course, the mention was really made in terms of the fact that what is he doing on a Sunday evening and how different is it going to be on Monday morning, and how does he seamlessly sort of move from one into the other. I think that was a great idea. But I think also what is required to get people to come in on Monday morning is not only the seamless integration between the Sunday evening experience and the Monday morning experience, but also in terms of the fact that you need to give a certain purpose to people. A purpose which is much higher than what would bring people in on a Monday morning. Something that they believe that they are doing which will change the world. So while there's a lot of good stories which is happening on the B2C e-commerce side, and there are lots of problems which are being solved over there as far as providing convenience and efficiency is concerned. So let's take Uber, solving a problem as far as taxis are concerned, or transportation is concerned, or Airbnb solving a problem as far as accommodation is concerned. But then when we talk about ourselves and the opportunity that we give to people is to solve big, major problems. Major problems which will make industries far more robust, which will make companies far more competitive, and which will drive growth in this country. Because if we are not able to actually drive growth in this country, we have a major problem, as you are well aware of. Because there are 12 million people who joined our workforce every year, and if you're not able to give them meaningful employment, we have a major demographic problem rather than a demographic dividend. So this opportunity that we give to them is in terms of coming and solving problems, big problems. And when we employ people, we really don't say that we are giving you employment or we're giving you a job. What we really say is that we're giving you an opportunity for you to make a change. And we are here as people who will provide you the infrastructure and the platform and certain amount of mentorship and nothing more than that. And everything else is something that if you guys are interested in doing, you need to do. One other thing that we find interesting to provide this purpose is that we run something called e-junction, e standing from empowerment, education, etc. Where our people, and there's over 60% of our own executives, we are 800 of us, over 60% of them volunteer their times before office hours, after office hours, over weekends, volunteer their own time to educate on the computer what people who are socially disadvantaged or financially challenged are unable to do for themselves. So we run training programs in our premises, which is spread across the eastern region largely and a few other places in Bombay and in Delhi, to hold classes for these people. 4 months classes where we teach them about the computer, where we teach them communication skills, very much with the purpose of making them employable. So last year we trained about 3,000 people and we made sure that 1,500 of them were employed. So this, once again, is totally a voluntary effort, and this is something else where we provide an opportunity to our own people to provide them a platform which says that if you want to give back to society, this is a way that you can give back to society. So we give, once again, the means for them to come forward. Some of them, like I said, 60% of them are interested in doing so, and they're very keen in doing so. Others are not. That's fine. That's not a problem. But once again, we give them an opportunity to actually do so. What is the greatest HR challenge for your company and business model? Well, the biggest challenge that I have is in terms of the fact that I think our HR systems are quite archaic, and what I've been hearing this morning is some of the stuff that if you guys are doing is far more than what we have even dreamt of doing. And I would imagine it is primarily because of the fact that we are Kolkata-centered or Eastern region-centered, that we are not privy to such changes which are happening as far as HR is concerned. So I would urge you, and I've taken cards from a number of you, and I will be in touch with you in terms of what we can do with you, because we believe, as far as the future is concerned, is for our growth and for the growth of others, it has to be a collaborative effort. And we would like to collaborate with others who can help us on this journey to improve upon our HR practices, which is from the time of how do we brand ourselves, how do we communicate to people that this is what we stand for, and if you're interested in joining us, this is the way you can join us, and if this is the way that you join us, this is what you can expect from us. So that entire holistic approach in terms of what is that HR experience that we can get, that we can give to you, which would be interesting to you for you to come and join us. So there was mention about middlemen and how do you tackle this to make Cold Junction a successful initiative. Yeah, so this was most definitely, as I mentioned, 25,000 crores of incremental revenue gathered by Coal India, which otherwise would have gone to the coal mafia. So obviously the coal mafia were not very happy people when we did this. And as a matter of fact, the first e-auction event that we held, which was in the year 2005, we used to be housed in a building called Tata Center in Calcutta. And we had about 400 people who get out the building, and we got calls from the owners of the building who said, you know, what the hell is happening here? Which is really the starting point. And of course, our people were pushed down staircases, and I myself received various telephonic threats. But besides that physical and that sort of mental anguish, what these guys really did was to go to every high court in India and to file a case against Coal India and against mjunction to withdraw this system which had been introduced. And the reason that they gave for that was in terms of the fact that this is a public sector, which is Coal India, and public sector has not been set up to make profits. And it is the public sector's requirement or objective to distribute the coal and not really to make profits. But it would be amazing to know that since the time Coal India or coal mines were nationalized in the early 70s, none of the coal companies have made a profit till such time as we introduced the system where they could very efficiently and transparently sell their coal. So there was difficulty from the middlemen, there was difficulty from the coal mafia, but then there were a few strong people who stood by our side. And one, of course, was the coal secretary. The other one was the chairman and managing director of Bharat Cooking Coal, who went on to become chairman of Coal India. We were also very lucky in terms of the fact that at that point of time, there was no coal minister. Mr. Shibu Soren used to be the coal minister, and he was locked up in jail for having murdered somebody that he should not have. So this was the time that we introduced this concept. He came back after serving 6 months of time in jail, and he came back as coal minister, and he tried to stop what we had been able to do. And we were fortunate that we were able to withstand that pressure. And of course, Mr. Manmohan Singh was the prime minister, and he kept quiet, so things worked out fine. So this was the story as far as coal was concerned, which was a big story. Then, of course, as far as coal is concerned, steel pales into insignificance. But the problem that we had with steel, which was earlier, led us to become stronger. And hence, we were able to sort of withstand the pressure that was put on us as far as the middlemen were concerned. But really, it was in terms of the fact that if you're solving problems, these people know that, look, their days are numbered and they get out of the way. So we understood very clearly that at times they were adding some value. And what is that value that they were adding? So for example, Tata Steel, let me give that example, would sell on cash. But the small buyers didn't have the cash to pay. So you had a middleman who would offer them ridiculous rates of interest, but they had no choice. So we said, hey, you know, there are things like banks, and why are banks not lending them the money here? Isn't this the job of banks? And we went to the banks to understand why they were not giving them the money, and we understood the problems that they were facing. So we worked out a solution which addressed the concerns of the bank, which gave money to the small guy, and the small buyer was able to pay the large supplier upfront and pay the bank after 60 days. And this means we are today giving about 6,000 crores of such funding, not funding by us, but getting the banks to fund these small buyers of steel and coal so that they are able to buy steel and coal directly from the major producers of steel as well as of coal. I think there were some more questions. Why have they disappeared? Yes. Okay. How did technology assist in dealing with the government agency? Were they adaptive enough? You know, as far as government agencies are concerned, I think we were able to succeed largely because of the fact that they did not know what we were doing. And I think that is true for any industry that has succeeded in this country. It is only because that the government has not understood what is happening, and by the time they understand what's happening, it's already done. So whether it is the garment industry, or the IT industry, or the Miss World industry, and now, of course, the e-commerce industry. So really, we have tried to stay away from government agencies as much as possible. But today, we find them coming in, and as far as e-commerce is concerned, which is really B2C, they're defining what is e-commerce, they're defining what is e-marketplace, and the reason that they're defining this is because they're running into problems. And, you know, the right hand doesn't know what the left hand is doing. I, as had been mentioned earlier, I'm with CII, and we continuously work with both the central government and state government to really educate them, to share with them that regulation is really not something which is required. What you need to do is to become a facilitator, to understand that technology is the future, and if that is the future, then how do I actually work in embracing this technology? How do I actually leapfrog, and how do I provide, at the end of the day, new employment for new skill sets to people? And how do I make sure that this entire story happens in a very effective manner? As a business lead in Eastern region, what people challenges did you face? Well, one was, of course, in terms of the fact that if I meet you and you impress me and I want you, but you're based in Bombay or in Bangalore, how do I take you to Calcutta? So this negative perception in terms of what Calcutta stands for is a major no-no. How do I encourage you to come to Calcutta? Calcutta is not a bad place. It's thank you. You know, we had a choice. And I'm talking about the year 2000. PwC were our consultants at that point of time, building this beautiful business plan. So we also asked them, in terms of where do you think we should be based? Let me also say that that business plan that they made, we threw out of the window because of the dot-com bust. But that is not saying anything about PwC, because all consultancies were giving the same business plan to everybody who was coming up at that point of time. We had to rewrite a business plan. And that's what led to our success and our continued success, because we wrote it. We wrote our own strategies and things. But as part of the advice that they gave us, they told us, look, if you're setting up an e-commerce company, the first place that you should go to, or the number one place in those days, I'm talking about 2000, is Bangalore, second is Gurgaon, third is Hiranandani, you know, Powai, four is Pune, and I think Calcutta came number 9 or number 10. And as all great decisions in terms of where we should start off, and I went to my board and I said that, look, the suggestion is to launch in Bangalore or in Delhi, and I suggest we launch in Delhi. If the board supported me, we decided we will launch in Delhi, or we will be headquartered in Delhi. So I went back and told my wife that we have, you know, good news, we are going to Delhi. So she said, that's horrible news, yeah. So I said, why? You know, you are from Delhi. She said, no, I don't want to go back to Delhi. So of course, what did we do? And that's how we started in Calcutta. Yeah. And that's why we were successful. So there is this Delhi girl who used to be my wife, and she passed away, but she loves sort of Calcutta. So biggest HR challenge I've had is to get the right people to come and join me in Calcutta. Of course, now we have also opened regional centers, and we are posting out people to the other regions, because in this sort of virtual world and this, you know, telepresence and video conferencing and et cetera, FaceTime, whatever, Skype, you really don't need to be in the same city. But we needed to be in the same city at the time that we started. We don't really need to be in the same city today. But it would help if you were to come to Calcutta in the initial years to learn and to suggest, to build certain processes. And then, of course, after that, you can go anywhere in the country, and that's really not a problem. In the 50% people enabler pillar, you spoke of what, according to you, is the most important people element. Ah, attitude. Nothing can beat attitude. You can learn about everything else. I didn't know anything about technology. They made me the project manager for implementation of SAP. I was a marketing and sales guy. I learned about it. I was in marketing sales, so the people that I had who reported to me were marketing sales guys. I suddenly had a cross-functional team which had people from IT, from HR, from production planning, from scheduling, you know. It doesn't really make a difference. What you really need is the right attitude. If you have the right attitude, everything else you can learn. So as far as the people story is concerned, attitude is very important. And what comes a very close second is in terms of ethics, is doing the right thing. So a lot of people say that, look, you know, the ends justify the means. I grew up in Tata Steel, so I'm part of, you know, so to say, the Tata group. And for us, the ethics is very, very important. The means is more important than the end. And if you get the means going, the end will most definitely happen. And the ends will happen even better if you get the means right. So looking at this people story in terms of what is most important, attitude and ethics, these are the most important things, I believe. And this is what I talk to people before they join us, after they join us, and continuously talk to them about. Do you feel that HR as a function is in tune with business needs? Can they even articulate it? Yeah, you know, as a matter of fact, mentioned, and this sort of resonated very well with me, which was in terms of, you know, somebody was talking about go live, and somebody was talking in terms of the fact that the story starts at the time that you go live and doesn't end at the time you go live. I've been going to Vegas now for the last 8 years. The IBM has a technology conference there, and they sometimes invite me as a speaker. And what I used to find over there were other Indian companies, other speakers who would come and talk about this wonderful transformation that they've done as far as IT is concerned. And they would all, these would be CIOs, CTOs kind of guys who are presenting, and they would all end at go live. You know, these are the, this is what the problem was, this is how I implemented, these were the problems I faced, and finally I went live. And the story would end there. And when I would see others presenting and others from the other countries, they would never ever talk about the challenges they faced while implementing an IT project. They would talk about the benefits that the IT project brought about. And that I found was a huge difference. But over the years, I found that even the Indian companies have changed, and now they're talking about IT projects in terms of the benefits that they bring rather than the pain and the sleepless hours that they spent and, you know, the various issues that they had. And so this is very much in terms of the responsibility of HR is how do I support the annual business plan? How do I support the vision of this company? What do I need to do in terms of the growth of this company? And the direct linkage in terms of whatever I'm doing needs to positively impact that at a strategic basis, on an ongoing basis, is something that we talk to our HR people about. And of course, they are doing a lot as far as that is concerned. And I'm sure unless everybody, all the functions are able to push together in a holistic manner, the company never ever will grow. Right, I don't think there are any more questions. These were the top questions that I had. What were the market challenges you faced while introducing a technological disruption in an international market? You know, a lot of the stuff that we are doing today is conceptually different. So when it is conceptually different, it is not somebody else is doing it and I go to a client and say, look, I can do a better job than somebody else, which is not too difficult for me to do. I have to show how I'm better than him or more cost efficient than him. That's the easy story. But the business that we are in, it is called concept selling. Because what I'm doing over here, those guys are not doing over there. So I've got to go and tell them that, look, there's a new way for you to do this here. And by doing it in this new way, this is the way you will benefit, and I am capable of sort of doing this for you. So that concept selling is something which takes time. So the time for me to make a sale is very long. So there's a downside, which is in terms of the fact that my sales cycle is very long. And especially if it is overseas, then the cost of that doing it overseas becomes so much more expensive. But on the positive side, if you have a long sales cycle, what does it mean is that there are high barriers to entry. That means if I'm able to make the sale and there's a long sales cycle, then my client is going to find it difficult, if not impossible, for him to move out of that and to go to somebody else or to try to do it himself. So this is really a double-edged sword, but I like this double-edged sword because of the fact that it makes my business far more sustainable. So the customers and the clients and the services that I was offering 15 years ago, I continue to offer today. I have no attrition as far as my customers are concerned, which makes this very, very sustainable. Of course, I continuously keep adapting my service to meet the changing requirements of the customer, which is fine. Because what you offered 15 years ago is no longer is basic hygiene. You have to come out with something on top of that, constantly adding new value. But that's fine. The only issue as far as overseas is concerned is in terms of the fact, you know, much like as I come from Kolkata and you say, well, hey, you know, what the hell are you doing here? Is when I come from India and I try to sell a concept to the Western world, they ask me in terms of the fact, who are your customers overseas? And then that becomes a chicken and the egg story, which is in terms of, look, I got to start somewhere before I get some experience or I get some references overseas. So if anything has held us back is in terms of our overseas sales is concerned, is also in terms of the fact that India is growing. India has a great deal of requirement. I am fully booked at this point of time with my human resources. So if there's any resources which I lack, it's not money as you can make out, because we've been profitable from the first day. It's nothing else. It is not technology. Technology is fantastic. It's amazing. It's only is in terms of people who can come and understand that if this is a pain point or this is a problem, how do I use technology to solve this problem? And that's it. And it's not even new technology. This technology is somebody else, Airbnb has used, or, you know, Amazon has used in some other context. How do I bring that over here and use this in a concept which is in a B2B context, in a commodity context, and which actually solves a problem? So if there is any challenge that I have is human resources. So those of you who would like to assist me, help me, guide me as far as HR is concerned, I'll be very, very grateful. I'm sure you will know my email ID. Please do write in to me. I'll be happy to engage with you. Thank you.